going to talk about Get Out and Split. There's no supersonic reason for this pairing, just that we've watched them both at the same time. So we're going to talk about both of them, but they're both sort of horrors in some stance. Thrillers, I would rather describe it, less horror, more thriller. And both of them are they're not blockbusters like majority of the films I usually talk about. These ones are more low budget type of things. Like Get Out cost only $10 million, that's only in their terms. And Split cost 4.5. That's way less. Yeah. So
wasn't Get Out 5?
I reversed them.
Yeah.
Get Out was 4.5. Split. Oh, the visual effects. Oh,
yeah.
Yes.
Oh my goodness. Oh my goodness.
So
that's a legendary.
No.
Split was a bit more.
Yes.
So
Split
like,
cost
$10 million.
Get Out cost $4.5 million. But they're both from the same production company. Have you heard of
Blumhouse?
Yeah, it's
make
really way renowned for having low budget, particularly. Low budget horrors. Paranormal Activity was their
biggest
blow. Yeah, because that one cost like $15,000.
It was, it was Blair Witch Project which had the record for the biggest returns.
Yeah.
It was,
yeah.
Now Get Out has the record for budget to revenue ratio.
Does it beat Paranormal?
It has the record right now.
Really?
Yeah.
I hope it does.
Paranormal beat Mad Max, I think the older ones, and this one has beat Paranormal.
But that's not
no, it was Blair Witch Project, which it beat, not Paranormal Activity.
Okay, I didn't know that. Anyway, warning to those who haven't watched, poor Nick. But we're going to reveal spoilers most likely along the way. Anyway, let's first talk about Get Out, which was directed by Jordan Peele from Key and Peele. He talks about how he got inspiration to write this film around the time Obama became president, because people began to think that racism was over around that time. So it's like, yeah, racism is not over, of course. So he made this film. It stars Daniel Kaluuya from Black Mirror and Alison Williams from Girls. If anyone watches Girls, I find her the perfect casting for this film because she's basically the same character that she is in Girls. She's the whitest girl you could ever imagine. And yeah, it's about the two of them being an interracial couple, and Daniel Kaluuya is going to meet her parents and shit goes south. That's the best way I can put it.
You got your toothbrush?
Check.
Do you have your deodorant?
Check.
Do you have your cozy clothes?
Got that.
What?
Do they know I'm black?
Should they?
You might wanna, you know.
Mom and Dad, my black boyfriend will be coming up this weekend. I just don't want you to be shocked, but he's a black man.
I ain't never seen you like this before, bruh.
Meeting families, taking road trips. Don't come back all bougie, man.
Come back, get your damn pants up to your damn stomach.
I'm shocked you didn't mention he's Ugandan.
Okay, fine. Daniel Kaluuya is he's a British born Ugandan. He's basically British.
He's British, basically.
He's
yeah,
British.
But he has Ugandan heritage in him. So we claim him. He's Ugandan. A Ugandan. We're doing a Ugandan movie.
But he spoke about
like, let's
it.
Let's go all the way.
Has he?
He spoke about
how in the US, okay, he's not black enough. Like even they complain he's not black
yes,
enough.
Yes.
Then he comes to Uganda and he doesn't even know the language. And kind of he referenced Uganda. So.
Oh, cool.
He talked about it, so he knows he's from here. It's not like we're here talking about his heritage. The man doesn't even know he's from Uganda. Okay. Anyways, so let's talk about the film. I like this film a lot. I think it's really, really clever. I think it has very many funny moments. I think it's very well. What's the word I wanted to say? It's very well.
God.
I had a word I wanted to use. Wait! I've remembered the word.
Yay.
It's well calculated, not structured. It's very calculated. Like things that happen in the beginning come all together at the end, and it was done in a very brilliant way because there's so many scenes that take place, and sometimes I thought they were just filler scenes, and he was just trying to. Depict some sort of racial, make some sort of racial point, but he wasn't. But Joel, I want you to start first with the normal discussion. It's still a description.
No, it's okay. Awesome. So this is the best horror film that I've seen in a while, a long, 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 long while. Jordan Peele is a fucking awesome director. I'd see him get more money to do more stuff. So this is our, this is a very interesting sort of take on racial tensions in America, but it deals with like racism from white liberals,
yeah.
Which is something I sort of related to. I found myself relating to on the way, because I've had encounters with seemingly open-minded white people, but there's this sort of undercurrent of racism that's usually present when you're talking to them. And he really hammered the point home with this, and it's loaded with so many funny lines. My favorite is, because again, the whole deal with this movie is that the white people keep calling attention to his blackness.
Mm-hmm.
Like, to show how not racist they are, you meet a black guy, you bring up black stuff. Like, this guy talking about, like, how he likes golf, he has to bring up, oh, I know Tiger.
Tiger.
He meets this Shakespeare for the first time, she's like, oh, I would have voted for Obama a third time if I could. Just, they keep drawing attention to his blackness over and over and over again, and sort of commending him for being above the normal black person, which is also racist in of itself. And I've had a few encounters of, like that, of, like, oh, you're so well-spoken for an African. I know it's supposed to come off as a compliment, I suppose, but
it's very
condescending. It's very condescending. And what I liked, we're allowed to talk spoilers, yeah?
Yeah.
Yeah, awesome. So the premise of this movie is that Kaluuya is in this interracial relationship. He has a fiance, right?
Yeah.
And he goes to meet her parents, and they live like in this big suburb with a fancy mansion. And I love that that first dinner scene where all these white people are around, and there's this portly gentleman. I haven't seen a portly gentleman in movies
in
long
what?
Time.
Fat guy.
Portly. No, he was portly, not a fat guy, but you know, portly like. Very gentlemanly
yes,
bulge.
Okay.
Yes, a gentlemanly bulge, though. So this dude is like, he says this line, is like, the pendulum has swung. Black is in fashion. And that just cracked me the fuck up. It was like such a sincere, unintentionally racist thing. And you have this chick that's all over him, like, oh, is it true what they say about black men?
How handsome is he?
Are you handsome?
Not bad. So, is it true? Is it better?
Wow,
wow. Wow.
Fair skin has been in favor for the past, what, couple of hundreds of years? But now the pendulum is swung back. Black is in fashion.
Yes, there's all this creepy stuff, and then there's all these weird black people around that are all like servants, and they're all acting weird, and you're like, what's up? And then, spoilers, it turns out that white people are sort of implanting their brains into black bodies. Because they envy sort of our strength and physique. Like, they want all our physical advantages.
Yeah,
yeah. But their brains and their drive, the drive of a white person combined with the strong body of a black person. Like, a lot of things are creepy.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I mean, the movie is mostly funny and satirical, but does have genuinely creepy moments. What do they call that that dimension where you get thrown?
The sunken place.
That shit was creepy as fuck. And yeah, there's a lot of subtext going on there with like black people sort of being passengers in their own lives and sort of being restricted to how white people interpret them.
Yeah.
And the build-up all the way to the end, I liked. I even liked the conclusion. I thought it was going to end tragically, though. And
it was supposed to.
Yes, I read that. They actually shot
the
ending.
There were so many endings.
Yes.
That they shot.
Yeah. But I'm glad that it ended on an uplifting note. It was dark enough, I think, as it was.
Mm.
And yeah, apparently he has plans. Like, supposed to be a trilogy. Let's make like
a social thriller trilogy.
Yeah, and these are good. Again, yeah, I'm not usually a fan of heavy messages in my movies, but this was intelligent as fuck. And I applauded Jordan Peele is a genius. Is I think the biggest review of this entire thing. I thought people
yeah.
were overhyping the movie, but he's
it's
a legit
working.
Yeah. So I can't wait to see what he does next.
Tim?
From what I picked from this movie was more of racial tensions were there, but I felt it was more about cultural appropriation and a black identity in general. I felt that was covered very well in that movie. Yeah, because again, pretty much when you see like the poster at the house with the parents in the film, you probably think they're like a maid and you know the guy who works on the compound or something, yet it's just basically another white man, you know, in a black guy's body. So I really like that whole aspect of how, in a way, it covers indoctrination, because again, you know, they say like colonialism is like the greatest social experiment ever, because they came here, people in Africa were like in, you know, covering just their genitals, and but now guys dress in clothes wear. So I felt it touched that, the way people are being, their minds basically are being changed through whatever it is. Yeah, it's hypnosis and surgery and all that, but again, I feel in real life there's that very real problem of how probably the Western world imposes this culture on black people and sort of changes them.
Yeah.
Yeah, another thing I really liked from Get Out, besides, was the mood. Because there's this really cool scene, I think for me it's the coolest scene in the whole movie, when like the main guy, Daniel Kaluuya, walks through the house, and when he walks through, having this, the way he put down, have a conversation, when he goes up, they all stop, and so I really like the way they set the mood. Like
the good paranoia.
The paranoia of just you being in this very strange place with a lot of white people around you. Then he actually meets one, the one black person, and he finds he's also being turned. You know, so I felt it dealt with those two themes. The whole culture, the way people were saying they liked black people, they thought they were very athletic, you're very talented, good at music or instruments, whatever it is. And they're trying to take that away, which again you see people complain about that a lot in like African Americans in the US. Probably they are looked down on, they feel oppressed, but their culture is basically in the mainstream now, probably the biggest genre, I think. I don't know if it's a fact, probably me, I think it's hip hop, because you check on the billboards, just rap music you get. So it has that kind of thing of where white people are sort of trying to take over what is essentially black. So that's what I really liked. Another thing are the supporting, Daniel Kaluuya was great, Alison Williams was great, but it's called Lil Rel Howery, that's his I think stage name. The guy works for the TSA. I felt he was amazing, man. He killed me. He had lines. There's that line where he was talking to this Alison Williams chick, and even he first pressed like hold.
He
was like, I know this motherfucker is lying, you know. That scene just killed me. And even I like the whole idea of the endings. It's another interesting thing I saw from like a filmmaker's perspective, how Jordan Peele first shot one ending, the ending that we see in the film. Then there's an ending where he actually kills the white chick and police comes. Then also there's the normal, the ending where he kills the chick and then his friend comes still. But the way he played with it, how he left her, the police guy is coming, you think this guy is screwed, you find out it's his friend, then they all leave them there.
Yeah.
I felt that was also quite playing with conventions again. You thought if it was going to be more of like the heavy handed, probably Spike Lee would have probably ended it with this guy being arrested and there's this heavy message behind it, you know. This guy is suffering for nothing, was defending himself, but it wasn't the case. I felt Jordan Peele's perspective of he was trying to be as objective as possible. You could have gone straight out, you know, anti-white people, but I felt he walked that line very well. He didn't go too much into the anti-white people talk that most probably political filmmakers have, especially in Africa. And he also didn't go for just probably straight up, because it's a satire. He didn't go for too much humor also. The humor is there, but again, it's still a horror film. There's basically comic relief from the friend and all these other funny lines, but it's still a horror. So it's one of the things I really liked about this film. Move forward, I hope.
I don't know where to start, but I'm going to start with the sunken place. He wasn't on the nose about the political parts of it, but he was being really political about it, because the way he talks about the sunken place, he says how black people are so marginalized, and however hard they scream, you can't hear them. It's like you're telling a black person to hide behind a persona, you want to them to hide their true identity and just be this image that black people want them to be, to just remain silent in a sort of way. So the concept of it is really scary. Imagine you have no control of your mind. And that scene really, they showed the creepiness of the sunken place when he meets the maid in the dining room, and then they show the expressions on her face when she's trying to come out of
the
sunken
amazing,
place.
The
oh my goodness.
Yeah.
That woman was amazing. Yeah. So those two characters, who they the two black people who they see in the house, who are the housekeepers, were so weird, and just showing how a white person just can't wake up and be black. Because in the moments when they encounter him, they're supposed to probably act normal, like normal black people.
Yeah.
But they're so weird. It almost even makes it seem like black people have a way. They have like, you can recognize another person even just when they say hi to you. And they're not sounding normal. It's like you're not being you. This isn't you. He immediately knew something was going on. And that also set up the creepiness which you talked about, which was really, really cool. And also, I liked how the joke of the whole thing was black, was white people, which is also another thing, how they always kill off black people in horror films. Oh, you don't even get a chance to cheer them to be the champs. Yeah, like, it really was a great horror movie for a black person in any way. I also want to talk about how well calculated it was. There were scenes, like, for example, the major one was when we see him with his girlfriend, and then she asks him to not show the police the ID. You look at that scene and think that she's on his side. Those are scenes that set her up to seem like she was on his side. But at the end, you realize she definitely wouldn't have wanted the police to see his ID, because they would have identified him in that point where he was being lost. Like at that point when his best friend was looking for him, like that's when they would have run his ID and have seen that he was actually there. That then also this blind guy who wanted him to be his, to enter his brain, to put his brain in him. Those scenes, I was like, why the fuck are we looking at a blind dude and all this that he's going on and on about? And another part was the wrestling. His dad, who was a wrestler, then it could, because that becomes the backstory on why these people are, because he's the one who brought up this whole family to be the way they are, because his whole story was the black. That was the first time a black person defeated another white person. So at that point, he knew that black people were strong. And he's like, let me get a strong black body and get the black person's strength. And that also plays into the social construct where like white people barely see black people as people. They just see them as this thing. Like they're not actual people. They're just a stereotypical thing in their heads. And all they want to use is their strength to their advantage. Which was really, really cool. The comedy relief was so good. He was almost like his voice of reason the entire time. My best scene was when he was writing down the options of what could possibly be. Then he scrapes out magic.
There's no magic.
Nothing killed me. This movie is so good. It breaks me every time I show it to someone and they don't like it. I'm like, how can you not? This is the most brilliant thing. This is one of the few things where it lived up to the hype. It just lived up to all the hype that it had going on around it. Yeah. Tim, you had something else?
Like the one thing I think I really probably wanted to see, like would have been the perspective of the person, like, you know, who's in the sunken place, seeing, like, say, how the police, for example, would react to him. Like, I don't know, I just...
How so?
Like, I'm just saying, like, you know how
that
guy's demeanor changed?
The character, like, he's that guy of
Thingy,
he was in the sunken place.
Exactly.
That we
so,
saw him.
So I would have liked, like, even if it was Daniel Kaluuya, and say...
You'd want to see him
I'd want to see,
place.
No, I would just want to see how a person in the sunken place perceives the world around him when now it's actually a white brain.
Oh, I get what you're saying.
I would have just something that I would have liked to see in this movie that I know probably would have stretched it like at least 40 minutes more. It would have been probably like 2 hours, 30 minutes, but it's just something that I felt like, how would they have utilized the sunken place just besides the horror part?
Yeah,
like for also the commentary, how would they have used it?
No, though for like horror, don't you think like less is always better?
Yeah, I
like
do.
The less the more scary it is.
No, I think it's the less you see.
Yeah, basically,
the less you see with like the antagonist, like I think that's the rule with horrors. Like the less you see the villain, the demon, whatever that's scaring you to like the end,
it has
a bigger payoff.
Yeah.
But I'm saying like just this guy who was in this black body being a white person, I'd have probably liked to see how, if the police would act differently towards him, does it change anything? Or is he still just a black person wearing fancy clothes? You know, that kind of... Which could be the thing, because out of Purdue, that you make some money, you high society now, but in the end, you're still... I think that's a Kanye line. In the end, you're still a nigger, you know? Which is something I would have really liked to see them.
Even if you make seven figures,
you're still a nigger. So something I would have liked to see them, like, play around with.
Not a Kanye line.
So who's
Killer Mike.
Killer Mike. So, no, I had it from Kanye. Probably just
quoting
him. No, Kanye's line was in All Falls Down.
Yeah. Well,
even if you're in a coop, you're still a nigger.
Yeah. Even if you still make seven figures, you're still a nigger. That's Killer Mike before All Falls Down.
So, that ending again, anyway, the way some people actually would have preferred that ending to be, in the end, you're still a nigger, in the end, you still go to prison, and you'll still be the victim because you killed white people. But the way, I liked how when the police come, you know that the police coming is not a good thing. And like in most movies,
it's just
the police coming is usually a good thing.
Relief.
But this is a fuck.
You're like, fuck. It's a weird thing for me.
Yeah.
Because even if we're not there, you understand. This guy is in...
Also, there's a scene I really liked. Although I think it was me just being an over-hopeful viewer. Like this scene when Alison Williams is trying to reach in her bag for the keys,
and
I actually
drags
believed
it out.
She was still in his side.
I didn't want to believe that she was against him.
Me too. I wanted her to actually be legit. Like
yeah,
I wanted her family to be cruel and for her to be legit, especially like her brother was so cruel. And that scene at the table where he comes up to him and like, if you push yourself, do you know that you could
be a fucking beast?
You could be a beast. That was the most descriptive way on how white people see black people.
Yeah, like
skin.
If you actually worked a lot harder, be unstoppable.
Be unstoppable.
But try every day, man.
Every
it's just
day.
The system that's.
Anyway, that has been our discussion on Get Out. To split Shyamalan
Ding Dong.
We're on to the Shyamalan Ding Dong.
We deserve some respect. M. Night
Shyamalan Ding
Dong.
Okay, let's go to M. Night Shyamalan. Yeah,
savage man.
We're not going to
have
this
made
argument
the comeback
again.
Yesterday.
But yeah, like we were trying to have a discussion before, Timothy was defending it over and over, but I think. Personally, I think he started off great. He went to do blockbusters indeed. He did badly with those. But he's come back to doing the small budget movies, and I think he's doing them better. And Split is one of the good ones. Also, since the bad ones are The Last Airbender.
After Earth.
Horrible.
that?
That's the pinnacle of bad. Let's stop there. Just anyone who did After Earth did a bad movie. So, Split is starring James McAvoy and Anna Taylor-Joy. Those are the two notable characters in this film. The film is about three girls being kidnapped and taken to like an underground room. That's where anyone who's kidnapped goes to. And they realize later that their kidnapper has 23 personalities. So they need to convince one of them to be able to escape from their abduction. That's the basic premise of the film. But of course, this is Shyamalan Ding Dong. So there's twists. There's twists. M. Night Shyamalan is known for twists. He did Sixth Sense, Signs, all the films. They have big twists, so.
Who are you? Help me get out of here, Hedwig.
You trying to trick me? I'll tell on you.
Aren't you the clever one?
An individual with multiple personalities can change their body chemistry with their thoughts.
Someone's coming for you.
Who's coming?
The Beast.
Let me start because I think my view on this film is very basic. So the movie had problems for me throughout while I was watching it. There were so many things. Like, I was enjoying it, but not so much. Some of the personality things were working for me, some were not.
Mm-hmm.
But the ending redeemed it for me.
Okay.
The twist, the beast twist. Like I said, guys, we're going to be spoiling throughout this film. The ending where we show the beast coming out as who he is what turned it for me, because at that moment, this film became for me a comic book villain story. That's all it became, and I loved it. It was, that's it. Like, after that, I'm like, this is the shit. Yet the whole time, I'm like, this is not exactly the sauce. You know, this is not great. But that actually worked for me when I looked at it in that perspective.
Mm-hmm.
I'm like, this is good. Because it was really a film that wasn't embodying anywhere towards realism, especially with the disease they're working with. The 23 personalities and this, the way they were using that disease and him, just the whole concept of it. But
yeah,
when I look at the ending, made me look at it as just a sci-fi movie. Like a sci-fi thriller about coming out of a villain. And then the real twist, which isn't him becoming the beast, the real twist of it being a sequel to Unbreakable, now just sealed the deal for me. I'm like, you mean Shyamalan is making us universe? Sign me up! I'm like, kawa! Like, that's when I'm like, this is actually a good film. But throughout, it was super, it went from mediocre to good at the end. That's my general view of this film. There are other aspects that I have to talk about, but this is mainly it. Tim?
Split, Shyamalan, as you've said, he had a turbulent few years in the middle of his career. Turbulent is an understatement. I think basically guys thought his career had gone at some point. He was never going to make another film again.
Yeah.
But he came back with A Visit, very nice indie horror film. Then this was his follow-up, which even I think was probably received much better. I don't know if it was received.
Yeah.
I'm not sure, I haven't checked.
Yeah,
but again, it was an interesting film seeing, and again, let me start from the opening credit sequences. The opening credit sequence is one of the most inventive I've seen. I actually loved it. Having everyone's name like split into I don't know how many other director, Shyamalan with like 27 other or something like that, then the DOP. Yeah, so I liked that a lot about opening. I don't think many people talk about opening credit sequences, but still, after that,
dang at
yeah. It's a dying art form, because at some point it was something that was led.
Yes.
It was yet to be someone who was really innovative to make something different.
Yeah.
Anyone can put words and a font, but you know, having to do it in a way that's, again, working with the film is something out of port. Don't also pay attention to. So the guy had, which disorder was it? Dissociative personality disorder.
Multiple personality.
Yeah, where different people, one person has these different personalities that at that moment when they're in that particular personality, it's 100% true.
Mm.
Yeah, and I felt that was really cool because, again, we're allowing spoilers.
Yeah.
The one thing I didn't understand, like the beast, the whole part of the beast,
yeah,
is something I kept wondering, who is this beast? Who is this guy who's going to come and mess up stuff? But in the end, it was McAvoy who was becoming this even green size, kind of shows the power of the mind in a way.
Yeah.
Another thing I liked about this film was, let me see, the lead actress. I think I'd only seen her in The Witch. She was in The Witch.
She was in The Witch.
Is it Robert? It's called Rupert Eggers, something like that.
And she's called Anya Taylor-Joy,
yeah. I thought she was quite good. And again, there's also her story. There's the story of these girls who are abducted. Then they intersperse that with like kind of like her backstory,
yeah,
and how she came to be who she is, this awkward girl, you know, in her teens and all that. So it was also pretty interesting as a character study. It wasn't just like, you know, this thriller film of this guy has abducted chicks, is tormenting them all. It was also basically kind of showing how, in a way, people become shattered, because in the end, that's the kind of thing I think the Beast he spared her for.
Her innocence,
because she has actually gone through, which again, I don't know, I'll talk about this later.
Yeah, because she had scars.
Yeah. But again, I really liked James McAvoy's performance. I think he did a good job pulling off all these characters, because he plays a woman, he plays a child, he plays like this. I think, was he gay? The guy was a fashion designer. He had kind of like. But anyway, there's also the Barry. I don't know. Barry was the guy, the main guy, the guy who abducted the chicks, the personality,
yeah,
Barry,
mastermind.
The mastermind, and the lady was called who?
I don't know,
but the lady also, it was quite amazing just see how this guy juggled these three roles. I know there's a movie with Kate Blanchett coming out, the one where she plays like 25 characters. and was all that hype about it, but I was like, man, this guy has really done a pretty good job portraying.
Kate Blanchett's thing is super artsy.
I'm sure it's going to be artsy. You've seen it?
I've seen a bit, yeah.
I haven't even seen, but they did a pretty good job portraying all these different characters and all their nuances and how the kid, you know, because actually believes that he's a kid. Okay, he is a kid in that moment, according to the movie. He can't even fight, like, say, a Barry Wood, the old, the maniac, basically. I felt it was really cool. For the other, I don't know why, because I weirdly felt like the other two actresses were just there for the ride. They really didn't, I don't know, they were just, I think, devices in the story, because they really didn't have that much going for them in general in the story. There wasn't a lot said about them, but for the chick Anya Taylor-Joy, there was a lot going on. Let Joel talk.
So Split is, I think you're calling it a comeback, is an understatement. Yeah, Shyamalan hasn't had an easy couple of years or decade.
Must be a decade.
But I'll say this for him.
Yeah.
Even through all that shit fest, he still managed to keep making
movies
and somehow finding money to do so. So
it's a miracle.
Yeah, as much as I disliked his movies, I admired his persistence.
Exactly.
And I did want him to win, by the way, every time. So finally he has. And Split I enjoyed from beginning to end. It's a slow burn movie. Very slow burn.
Very.
And I usually like movies like that. So actually the standout performance for me was that was Anna, by the way. I hadn't recognized that. I knew I'd seen her somewhere before, but it's not until I checked after that I knew she was in The Witch as well. But she has super expressive eyes, and she was able to subtly like portray this sort of sort of dark past. I didn't think they were going to dig into her all that much, by the way. Because basically, yeah, he kidnaps his three girls, and he talks about how there's going to be this massive sacrifice, and that the beast is coming. And I personally enjoyed that entire concept. The fact that it had touched on Unbreakable was spoiled for me, unfortunately, before I saw the film. So basically, you have this whole concept of like James McAvoy has all these personalities that are each fighting for control of the light. His character is named Kevin, like the original character. And Kevin has his personality disorder that he's supposedly keeping under control. Like, he's supposed to have settled into this one personality, the fashion designer. I forget what his name was.
Barry.
Yeah, Barry, yes. And apparently, yeah, not everything is as it seems. And apparently there's like this coup within his mind where these personalities gang up together and shut out all these others for control of the light. So you have like these religious fanatical personalities who believe in this ultimate personality called the Beast, who can like crawl on walls and has the strength of 10 men and all this cool shit. And yeah, they speak about like this mythology and these arguments that, oh, that's some far-fetched stuff. There's this whole big conspiracy, and there's this slow build-up all the way to the end. And with her name is Anna, right?
Anya.
She's actually Anya. Tim has corrected
Anya.
Me. Anya Taylor-Joy.
Okay, yeah. So Anya's character and the other two girls she's kidnapped with, of course, constantly trying to escape, which is like a subplot. So I like how, because Anya, like the other girls sort of react, I guess, normally.
Yeah, normally. Sure.
Like, to that situation, you'd just be freaked out. But Anya is like strangely cold, and she invites you to like, you want to know more about her, like why she is that way. Yeah, because at first they just sort of write her off as that. No, she's just a creepy, quiet chick. But then they like reveal this really dark backstory that really uncomfortable to watch, man. Like, once we saw it happen, I was not expecting that at all. Again, I love the slow build up all the way to the end, where she tries to play the personalities against each other, especially her dialogue with the kid personality. He was 9 years old, and James McAvoy plays that beautifully.
But there was a weird scene where he tried to like spoon with her. I was like, which 9 year old?
No, there's the this weird sexual curiosity. I know.
Probably 9 years.
No, because even the way he talked, like, can I kiss you? Can I? Yeah, that's just, yeah, that's about normal actually for that age. So basically, yeah, things build up, bodies drop as expected. Then the beast is finally unleashed and it's glorious. Like, all that slow build up pays off and he's a fucking monster. Of course, yeah, Unbreakable had already been spoiled for me. I was just sort of anticipating these are the three characters, because in Unbreakable you have Glass,
yeah,
played by
someone else.
Samuel Jackson, and you have who is the thing, his character, Bruce Willis.
David Dunn, something like that.
Yeah.
So apparently the next movie is Glass, right? They
Should
say
look it up.
Yeah.
It's Glass.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I can't fucking wait to see that. This dude is super OP. That beast is like ripping open iron bars. It's just like the power of the mind.
Mm.
Believed he was bulletproof, he became bulletproof. He believed he was super strong, he could crawl through walls, and he did it. He's like, and I like the way the superpowers work in this universe. It's like he was crazy enough to believe he had this power, and then he had that power, which was crazy.
Which is weird with Unbreakable, because
yeah,
Bruce Willis couldn't even understand how he had such powers. He's like, man, I can lift this much, and he kept telling his son to add weight.
Yes.
It has that.
Yes, I hope they actually dig a little deeper into that. Yeah, I actually want to watch Unbreakable again now. Sort of delve back into that universe.
Call me Mr. Glass.
Yeah, Glass. Fantastic villain. I can't wait to see him again.
The ending was so nice.
Yeah,
made me feel so happy. No,
that's Nick talking.
But did you see how you read about how he hustled, like, to get, he had to go to Disney, like, first hustle those guys, man, first give me like Bruce Willis, the Unbreakable guy, because you know, like, Disney, I think, was it Disney who had the rights over Unbreakable, which I felt, and it was a very good way to do, like, to build a sequel.
Yeah,
unlike most successful superhero movies, whereby you actually watch a movie and you know these guys are building for Star Wars, you know, they are building for something bigger in the end.
Yeah.
This one felt like a movie of its own, completely
standalone. Yeah.
It's only later on when Bruce Willis appears and you actually make the connection that it's, and connects much better than anything that would have been forced if they brought Bruce Willis in the middle of the movie.
It works well.
That's another way of saying this film works so well as an origin story of a villain.
Yeah.
And I feel like those superhero comics should do that.
Yeah.
Like, have your own origin story
have
for Thanos.
Movie.
And then we'll know Thanos
yeah.
better, and he will be more effective. Like, now we know his name is the Horde. You saw in the news they are calling him the Horde. So now we'll know the Horde. We know how he gets his powers. We know where they came from. He basically consumes people's personalities. We'll see him going all through that. We know now he doesn't consume innocence for some reason, because they set up that chick, and Anya Taylor-Joy, he sort of consumes, like, he eats out their stomachs then he, like, take, and he as if forms his personality.
Yeah, I thought he was more like punishing.
No, that was just the beast.
Really?
That was just the beast.
But this, his thing is to, like, to grow stronger, he consumes their personalities in some form.
Oh, cool.
So that will be so cool. So now we know him. I don't know what role that chick is going to have, because he puts so much time into her. I really hope she has a bigger role. Because she is going to be in the next. No, it's already
written there.
She's going to be in Mr. Glass.
Okay.
Which is Glass. Yes, okay, they call him Mr. Glass. But the name is Mr. Glass. But the film is going to be called. She's already there as part of the cast of the other film, which makes so much sense. Because all that build up that they had for her, there has to be more purpose for her. I really wonder, is she going to have some power?
I wouldn't mind that as an origin story, by the way, whereby they leave that character.
I wonder what
burn,
she
you know?
Will be all about.
Because
villains, to
be there.
And
so
even
funny.
The way they make her ending, I hope she doesn't go back to where she's supposed to.
Fuck, man.
Because they keep it open on whether she'll leave the car or report to the police about her case. But I hope I then will get to know more about her, because she was phenomenal in the film. He handled that scene very well, because it guts you, like, it's a very uncomfortable thing, and the way it was portrayed was super, super, super uncomfortable. But it was done really, really well, in my eyes. But yeah, this film worked for me in that way. Origin story, man, do more of these.
I like this whole universe. This guy is plotting out. Shyamalan. Seems a more interesting type
it's
of universe.
So interesting.
It seems a more anime type of universe,
yeah,
which is why I'm interested in it.
I'm
yeah,
actually
in
it does, by the way.
Because, especially because, for me, okay, this whole personality thing didn't come off as a twist to me. I told you I haven't watched this movie, but I know everything about it. It didn't come off as that big of a twist to me. What was interesting was that it was a sequel. Then I was like,
you know, that's what I meant.
Holy.
And it's not that it was a sequel.
That's
what I knew about. You
because
know,
then I started remembering.
Yeah, that was the twist was
Mr. Glass. Because the first thing that came into my head was that twist at the end of Unbreakable.
Yeah.
That's of all Shyamalan's twists, that's the one that hit me the hardest.
this
guy had finished everything up. He was a hero, he was triumphant, and his mom is taking him through a comic book museum and telling him, you see how the villain has huger eyes because he has a new perspective of things. That was this artistic style. And in your head, you're thinking, hey, Sam Jackson has huge eyes. But okay. And you see how this guy is portrayed as a powerful guy. And this guy's like, and you're like, oh, fuck me. Like, and then Sam Jackson starts doing his whole exposition. He's like, you know how I know I was the bad guy? They called me Mr. Glass.
No.
Fucked with me.
No, man, that
like, intimately. And then I saw this movie and it fucked with me intimately, even reading about it. Like, this is a good universe right here.
It's a dope.
It's a
because like just thinking about it, like, okay, we can, for the split, we can go back a bit to Unbreakable now, but I feel, man, like a guy who's actually like Mr. Glass is such an interesting villain. Like,
it's so interesting. It's
so brittle. But he's the guy causing everyone headache. He's such a unique
like
villain. He's so unique.
He's
not
he's
General
like,
Zod.
He's
not
like something out of Amelie.
Yeah,
you
know.
Pretty
it's
pretty
much
the guy in Amelie, except an asshole.
But still, man.
They called him Mr. Glass.
They called him Mr. Okay.
I was finding him as.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
That was Nicholas, by the way.
Yeah, I already mentioned
he's
back there, hasn't watched the films, but has had all these spoilers.
Yeah.
So, in case
you
listen, you're not alone.
Yeah.
Okay, this has been our episode. Thanks for listening. Joel, Timothy, and me.
And Nick.